may proceed.
Thank you, Judge. So, I just asked, can you state and spell your first and last name for the record?
Mm-hmm. Kimberly Frain, KimberlyFrain.
And, ma'am, I'm going to ask you to please keep your voice up. It's a big room and everybody needs to be able to hear you.
Do you mind if I call you Kim?
That's fine.
Okay. Is that what you go by?
Yes.
So, Kim, there's a microphone right in front of you. Everything that you say is being recorded. I'm just going to ask that you get a little closer to it because it's
Got
difficult
it.
To hear. Okay, that's much better. If at any point you can't hear me, let me know. I'm a little loud, so.
Okay.
Okay. Can you tell us your date of birth?
6/13/86.
And how old are you?
36.
Okay. And just now you had a mask on that was taken off.
Yeah.
It sounded like you didn't want to take that off.
No.
Why is that?
I have a job. I wear a mask every day. I work in healthcare. COVID. I was just dealing with someone who had COVID over there 5 minutes ago. So.
Okay. Where do you currently live?
I live in Meredith, New Hampshire.
And who do you live there with?
My parents.
Anyone else?
My daughter.
How old is your daughter?
She's 6.
And, prior to living in Meredith, where were you living?
With my ex, Chris Frain, in Manchester.
What was that address in Manchester?
252 Russell Street.
How long had you lived there?
Probably 6 years.
You mentioned Chris Frain?
Yes.
How long have you known him?
Probably 7 years, 8 years now.
Do you have a child with him?
Yes.
Is that the daughter you mentioned?
Yes.
And what were the years that you lived on Russell Street in Manchester?
I don't know.
Were you living there in 2019?
Yes.
And when did you leave that address?
2 years ago, maybe 3.
So back in 2019, and I want to focus on late 2019, September, October, who was living in that home with you on Russell Street?
Me, Chris, and my daughter.
Did you have any pets?
Yes, my dog.
What was your dog's name?
Jack.
And tell me about Jack. What kind of dog was Jack?
He's like a pit bull mix. And he's brown. He's a big dog.
Was he a guard dog?
Yeah. I'd say he barks.
And let's talk about that. When people would come, would he bark, come to the house?
Yes.
Always or just sometimes?
Always. Like, annoyingly always.
So, and you mentioned this briefly, what do you currently do for work? How are you employed?
I work in healthcare and I work at a hospital.
What hospital do you work at?
I don't want to say.
Okay. But you're in healthcare?
Yes.
How long have you worked in that field?
2 years.
Same hospital?
Same hospital.
And so I want to focus back on September, October 2019. Were you working in healthcare back then?
No.
Can you tell me what your life was like back then?
I was working at Dunkin' Donuts. Me and Chris didn't get along. We were both into bad things. We were in both bad places then. Wasn't a good time in my life.
So you said you were into bad things, you're in at a bad place.
Yeah.
And I wanna suss that out. I wanna talk about it a little bit more. What do you mean when you say you were in a bad place?
I was doing drugs, he was doing drugs. Bad things were happening all around us.
When you say you were doing drugs, what drugs were you using?
Heroin and cocaine.
Did you ever use crack?
That too. Yep.
And back then, how did you support that habit?
I was working at the time.
And you mentioned you were working at Dunkin' Donuts?
Yeah.
Which Dunkin' Donuts were you working at?
Beach Street.
Beach Street.
Beach.
Are there things that you did back then that you regret?
Yep.
Can you tell me about that?
Everything I did. I regret.
Yes. The objection is sustained. You can rephrase the question.
You mentioned you were doing drugs. Is that something that you regret from back then?
Yes.
Were you heavy into drugs back then?
Yes.
And you mentioned that back in 2019, your daughter would have been 2 years old?
Yes.
Do you want those things becoming public?
No.
How do you feel about having those, that time in your life, that dark time becoming public?
It's the last place I want to be right now. It's right here, right now.
You don't want to be here?
No.
And you don't want this information coming out to
No.
your coworkers?
Right. All my friends, my new life I created. I moved away from Manchester to get away from it all. Now, it's all back.
Are you ashamed of this period in your life?
Yes.
Are you currently sober?
Yes.
What did it take for you to become sober?
I went to rehab, and when I got out of rehab, I moved back in with my parents, my daughter. And I did like an outpatient program for like a year. I did meetings. Then eventually got a job.
You had mentioned you took yourself out of the situation.
Yes.
That was being in Manchester.
Yes.
How long have you been sober?
3 years in March.
So back in that time frame that we were talking about earlier, September, October 2019, who would you associate with?
Just want me to like name them?
Please.
Like friends. I worked at Dunkin' Donuts with Kayla and Adam, and I hung around some not great people. Like Ish and Manny and Mike and Amber.
And so I want to follow up on a few of the names you just mentioned, but first, so you were working at the Dunkin' Donuts on Beach Street, is that what you mentioned?
Yeah. Well, there was two of them. One was Beach Street, and then there was one that was in Irving Station.
Okay, and I think you mentioned you worked with Kayla?
Yes.
Who is Kayla?
Kayla Montgomery.
How long have you known her?
I don't know her like anymore, but when we worked together, we known each other for a couple years. We were both pregnant at the same time together.
So you were working together, you were pregnant?
Yeah.
Did you have a drug connection with Kayla?
It turned into that, yeah.
You mentioned Adam.
And Adam.
How did you know Adam?
Work.
And who is Adam?
Adam is Kayla's ex.
Do you know his last name?
Montgomery.
Okay. And you said, I think you said you worked with him at one point?
Yeah, he worked with us too for a little while.
And is that how you knew him, or was it more through Kayla?
Both.
I'm sorry?
Both, like we worked together and I knew him from Kayla.
And so back to Kayla, how would you describe your relationship with her?
We hung out like a few times. Like I babysat her kids like once or twice. We didn't hang out like a lot.
Okay.
I give them rides to work and home after work.
Do you know where they were living back then?
Yes, but I can't remember.
Was it in Manchester?
Yes.
About how far from where you were living were they?
Like 10 minutes.
And that's a 10-minute drive?
Drive.
Did you have a drug connection with Adam Montgomery?
Yeah, I'd call him and see if he could find anything.
Would you use drugs with him?
Yeah.
How would you describe your relationship with Adam Montgomery?
Just like acquaintances, drug friends.
I'm going to ask you.
Sorry.
You need to speak up. Okay, thank you.
Did you have items taken from your home back in 2019?
Yes.
Was that October 2019?
Yes.
Were you and your husband, did you go into a report of theft?
Yes.
So can you just tell us what happened that led to you reporting that?
Yeah, Chris went to work and he was gone for like a week. And when he came back, he noticed his guns were gone. And so he reported them, and then when the police showed up, Chris called me and had me also talk to them that day to report them.
So what items were taken?
Three guns, a watch, and I don't know what else.
Was a men's silver wedding band initially reported as being taken?
I think Chris reported it stolen, but it wasn't. I had pawned it like months before.
So it wasn't one of the items taken during this incident? Did you subsequently clarify that with the police?
Yeah.
Do you remember when that was?
No. When they asked me, I told them.
Any objection?
No objection.
All right. Exhibit 7A through E, the ID is stricken and they're entered as a full exhibit.
And may I approach the witness?
Yes, you may.
And so, Kim, I'm handing you what's been marked, or what's been. I'm handing you exhibits 7A through E.
Between those, if I could just ask. Is the ID not yet stricken on those?
No.
All right, so let me just ask for the monitor. If you would give them to the monitor first, you can strike the ID, mark them as full, and then I'll have you show them to the police. Thank you.
So, Kim, I'm handing you Exhibit 7A through E, and I just want you to look at each of those in turn and describe what they depict. So what are those documents?
The ring that I pawned. And that's me. And that's my ID. And that's my signature.
Okay, and when did you pawn that ring?
Mm. August 5th, 2019.
And you said that that's you in the photo?
That's me.
That's the ring that you'd pawned?
Yes.
And I think you initially mentioned, or I think you mentioned that you had clarified that subsequently with the police?
Yes.
You can just set those aside for now. So we're describing this incident where items were taken from your home. Did that have an effect on your life at the time?
Yeah, it was like the worst thing that could happen because it created, it was a robbery at our house where my daughter lives, so DCYF got involved. They tried to take my daughter away. It was a nightmare.
Okay, and so I want to unpack the events that you described.
Okay.
You said that your husband was out of town?
Yes.
And can you just describe when he left?
I don't remember exactly when he left, but he always left for work and would come back a few days later. And he traveled a lot for his job.
What would you typically do when he was out of the home?
I'm sorry?
What would you typically do when he was out of the home?
Work. I don't understand that question.
You'd continue to work?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hang out with friends, work.
And so on this occasion, did you hang out with friends at your home?
Yes.
Who did you hang out with?
Adam came over one night.
Do you know how he got there?
He drove.
And had he been to your home prior to that occasion?
Yeah.
About how many times would you say?
Maybe like 3 or 4 times.
And that night, did he come by himself or was he with other people?
He was by himself.
And why was he there?
Because we wanted to try to get some drugs together.
And was there more to that plan? Were you going to do the drugs together?
Probably, yeah.
What were you trying to get that night?
Crack.
Earlier you'd mentioned Kayla. Was she there that night?
No.
And can you just describe for us, how did he get to your home? So how did, from the moment he entered?
Like, I called him, and he came, drove over, and I let him in the house.
When you let him in, was that in the front door or the back door?
Front door.
And what did you do when he arrived?
We went into the living room, and I remember just sitting on the couch, and we couldn't find, do you want me to say that, like, the whole night?
So you're at the point where you let him in, you're sitting on the couch, what happened next?
Then I remember looking over at him and he was like half asleep and I had been up for like 3 days at that time and I remember just closing my eyes. And when I woke up in the morning, he was gone.
Before you had Adam over that night, had you seen those guns?
Yeah.
Okay, do you remember when you had last seen them?
I don't.
But it was after Chris Frayne left, your husband?
Yes.
Let me ask you this. Do you remember telling officers that you had stubbed your toe while you were making the bed on the guns that week?
Oh, probably.
Do you remember,
remember that, though. You
don't remember?
No.
Do you remember who you contacted for drugs that night?
No.
Who was your typical connection?
There's lots of people. There was Mike, there was Ish, there was Adam.
Those are all people that you had bought from?
Yes.
When you say Ish, do you know his name?
No.
When you say Mike, do you know his last name?
Yes, now I do.
What is his last name?
Sullivan.
So, at what point in time, I just want to understand the timeline, at what point in time did you contact individuals? Was it after Adam got there or before?
I don't know.
And did you reach out to Adam Montgomery, or did he reach out to you?
I don't remember.
When Adam arrived, you said you let him in your front door. Did your dog bark?
I would assume so. He always barks.
Was your daughter home at the time?
Yes.
And what was she doing?
Sleeping.
She would have been 2 around that time?
Yeah.
How was Adam acting when he got to your home?
Normal self.
And do you remember around what time he arrived?
No. It was like late at night, I remember that, but I don't know what time.
I think you mentioned that you looked over at him and he looked like he was half asleep.
Yeah.
How long had he been in your home for at that point?
Maybe like an hour, 2.
I think you also mentioned that you'd been up for a few days, 3 days.
Yes.
Why were you up for so long?
Because that's what drugs do to you, keep you awake.
So you'd been using drugs for the past 3 days at that point?
Yes.
At some point, do you believe you fell asleep?
Yes.
And what was the last thing you remember before that happened?
I just remember looking over at him and he looked tired, and we had the TV on, just watching TV.
Where were you in the house at that point?
I was on the couch and he was in the chair.
And the firearms that we were just discussing, where were they in your home?
Under the bed and in Chris's drawer, I believe.
Did he wake up at some point?
I woke up in the morning.
And describe what you saw when you woke up.
I woke up in the morning, Adam was gone. I went out into the kitchen and there was a pipe left on the table with like drugs still in it, which was weird because we didn't have anything that night. So that was weird. Then I went out onto the breezeway and there's like a back porch, and that door was wide open. And I thought that was weird, but I just shut the door and went on with my day.
And at that point, had you realized that anything was missing?
No.
At some point, did you realize that items were missing?
When Chris got home and he looked for them.
And would that have been the next day, or is that the day where you
woke up? I think it was a day or two later.
That Chris got home?
When Chris got home.
And describe Chris coming home and realizing the guns were missing.
He came home and he looked under the bed and he couldn't find them, and I helped him. We just like looked everywhere around the house, and then he got really mad once he realized they were really gone, and he started throwing things down the stairs and throwing things across the house, and he was very mad. And then we went to bed, and then he called them the next day to the police.
He called the police the next day?
Yeah.
Were you there when he called the police?
I wasn't when he first called, but the police said to have me come there. So Chris called me and I drove over there.
Okay. And I think you said that when he got back, he realized the guns were really gone?
Yeah.
What guns are we talking about?
All three guns.
Okay. And do you know what types of guns they were?
The two big guns and then the 380. I think it's a shotgun and the AR.
So you weren't there when he initially called. Did you return home?
Yes.
And was that while the police were there?
Yes. They wanted to talk to me, so.
Was there another gun in your home the night that those items were taken?
Yes, the 45.
Where was that kept in your home?
He usually keeps the two handguns in the drawer and then the two big guns under the bed, but I had the 45 in my car during that time.
When did you return? At some point, did you return the 45 to the drawer that you mentioned?
I don't remember doing it. I could have. I wanted to say I handed it to Chris, but it was 4 years ago, so I really don't remember.
Needless to say, though, the 45 wasn't amongst the items that were taken.
Correct.
So back in 2019, when you were living at that house on Russell Street, did you have security cameras?
No.
Were the guns in a safe?
No, he had a small safe, but he didn't put anything in it. I don't know why.
So, when you returned home that day, were the police there?
Yes.
Did you speak with them?
Yes.
In that statement, did you tell them Adam Montgomery had been to my house that
day? No.
Why not?
I really didn't think like a friend of mine would do that to me at the time, so I literally thought we just got robbed. Like, it's Manchester, it's bad. I thought we just got robbed by someone I didn't know.
At some point, did you become suspicious?
Yes.
Tell me about that.
I started hearing rumors from friends that Adam had taken them.
Sustained.
It's effect on the listener, Judge.
Approach.
Overruled.
So, based on the rumors that you heard that the defendant had stolen your firearms, what did you do next?
I heard from friends that he might have done it. And I was still working with Kayla, his ex-girlfriend, wife at the time. And when I went to work one day, I made up a lie to her about having the cops. I told her that the neighbors had cameras and I wanted to see her reaction because I was suspicious of them. And her answer to me was, which way do the cameras point? And when she said that to me, I just had like a gut feeling that he had done it.
You didn't have cameras though, that was the
But lie. We didn't have cameras, and the neighbors didn't have cameras, but I just made it up to see what she would say. And her response was, which way did they point?
Did the defendant know you had those guns?
Yeah.
How?
I think I told him when we were leaving the mall one day.
Was that about the AR specifically?
Yeah, just the AR.
So I asked you about your first statement to the police. You didn't mention the defendant. And that would have been right after this happened, correct? So I want to move forward in time. We were talking about September, October 2019. I want to move to December 2019.
Okay.
You have a major life event in December 2019?
Maybe.
Were you arrested by the
yes,
police?
Yes.
Would
I
you
was.
Consider that a major life event?
Yes.
Okay. What were you arrested for?
I had drugs on me.
And can you describe that incident?
I was at a gas station and I had drugs on my lap. And when the cops came, they saw them and arrested me.
What were you doing at the gas station?
Taking a nap.
So you were sleeping?
Yeah.
Were you outside or inside?
Inside the car.
Okay. So you got arrested.
Yes.
And did you, after being arrested, did you speak with detectives?
I think they asked me. I don't really remember that whole time.
Why do you think you don't remember?
Because I was on drugs.
Were you still using crack?
Yes.
Were you still using heroin?
Yes.
And I think you had mentioned cocaine as well.
Sure, yes.
So during the second interview, did you tell detectives that, or did you tell officers that you had said goodbye to Adam the next morning when you woke up?
I don't remember that.
So I want to fast forward even more. I want to talk about February of 2022. Did you meet with the detectives again?
Yes.
And is that when you told them the information about the pond items? Or the pond
That's
ring?
When they asked me about it.
You told them, I pawned the ring?
Yes.
Sustained.
During your February 2022 interview, were you sober at that point?
Yes.
So you were living a sober lifestyle?
Yes.
Did you have any of the memory issues that had been associated with your drug use?
No, not anymore.
Did you have any reason to protect Adam in your initial statement to police?
No.
Were you afraid of him?
Overruled.
Were you afraid of him?
Yeah.
So, Kim, I'm going to ask you to look at the jurors now. The acts that you admitted to doing, having this man in your home when your husband's gone, using drugs for days on end, those are all things that you did?
Yes.
Pawning your husband's ring, that's something that you did?
Yes.
Lending out a 380, is that something that you did?
Yes.
The night that the guns were stolen, the big guns, did you buy those guns or did you sell those guns?
No.
Did you trade those guns?
No.
Did you lend them out?
Yes. Not the big ones, but the little one.
So I'm talking about the night of the theft.
Oh, no. None.
So you didn't buy them? Or sorry, you didn't sell them?
No.
You didn't trade them?
No.
You didn't lend them out?
No.
Overruled. Go ahead.
And you had mentioned just now that there was one that you lent out.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us about that?
I did like twice lend them, but I got them back.
Which, was it them or was it one of the guns?
The 380.
Who would you lend that to?
Ish.
Yeah, and you don't know Ish's name, his full name.
I can't remember it.
The times that you lent them out, was that before or after the theft?
Before.
And you said you always got it back?
Yes.
Would you lend any other items out?
My car as well.
Did you always get it back?
Not always.
You were always able to get it back, though?
Yes.
Sustained.
Pick it up just a moment. So just a moment ago, I want to follow up. Just a moment ago, you mentioned them when I asked you if you'd lent the guns out. Were there other guns other than the 380 that you'd lent out?
The 45, I think, maybe once.
And who would that have been to?
Mike Sullivan.
Mike Sullivan. Did you ever lend the long guns?
No.
The big
I
guns?
Never touched those guns.
Why not?
They're huge and they just lived under the bed. I'm not comfortable touching them.
The event that you described, lending out the two smaller guns, was that something that was public amongst that circle of friends that you had?
Public, yeah. Like they knew. Everybody knew.
Everybody, including the defendant?
I would, maybe.
The person that you were using drugs with that night, or wanted to use drugs with that night, had over at your home?
Yes.
You said that was Adam Montgomery?
Yes.
Do you see him here today?
Yes.
Can Can you point him out and describe an article of clothing that he's wearing?
He's right there in a collared shirt.
Your Honor, can the record reflect the witness has identified the defendant?
The record should so reflect.
And thank you, Ms. Brain. I have no additional questions for you at this time.
To move the podium, Your Honor, closer to my desk. Ms. Fran, Frain. My name is Caroline Smith. And would you prefer Ms. Frain or can I call you Kim as well?
That's fine.
Okay, thanks. So a couple of things that I wasn't clear about on your direct. You said that you were not at home when Chris called you. You were not at home when Chris called the police, but you came home.
Right.
And you were at Mike Sullivan's when Chris called?
I believe, maybe.
Okay.
I don't really remember where I was, but I know I wasn't there and I had to come back.
Okay, and you knew that Chris was going to call the police?
Yeah.
Okay. I think that you said that your 45 was in the car when the long guns must have been stolen, the other guns, and that you put the 45 back.
I don't remember putting it back, but I could have.
Okay. But it's your recollection that the 45 was in the car at the time the other guns went missing?
Yes.
Okay. And let me see. I think you said you never touched the big guns?
Correct.
And okay. So on May 26th of this year, like a few days ago, that is when you told Attorney Knowles and Attorney Agati that you would lend the 380 to Ishmael Garcia and lend him your car, and you would do that in exchange for drugs, right?
Correct.
And you hadn't made that admission before, right?
What do you mean?
That's the first time you told him that, right?
I don't think so.
Okay, we'll go through. When you let Ishmael Garcia take the 380, it was when Chris was out of town, right?
Right.
And when you let Ishmael Garcia take the car, it was with Chris out of town, right?
No.
You'd loan him the car as well when Chris was in town?
Yes.
But the 380 would be when Chris was out of town?
Right.
And it would not be done with Chris's permission, right?
Correct.
It would not be done with Chris's knowledge, right?
Correct.
It would not be done with Chris's consent?
Correct.
And Chris would not have approved of that?
Correct.
And let's talk about who Ish and Manny are. You actually mentioned Ish, and that's Ish Garcia, right?
Yes.
And Manny is somebody who hung with him quite a bit, right?
Yes.
And Ish was generally your dealer?
No. He's one of them.
Okay. And often if you needed drugs, you'd be able to call Ish, and he would bring you some.
Right.
And did Ish have the car that night?
I have no idea.
Okay. So it could be that Ish had the car while Adam was over at your place, right?
Maybe.
Okay. And you would let Ish borrow your car in exchange for drugs or money, right?
Yes.
And there were some drugs on your counter when you got up in the morning.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think you said that you didn't always get your car back.
Yeah.
And one of the things with that is you'd actually tell Ish, I need it back by a particular time, maybe for your daughter, maybe for work, and he just wouldn't bring it back in time, right?
Yep.
You got stuck more than once with Ish not bringing the car back in time, right?
Yes.
And Ish would kind of laugh at that, right?
Yeah, probably.
And you had to, you sort of let him get away with it because you wanted to keep that drug connection open with Ish, right?
Sure.
And I think that you said not only did you let him use or take the 380, but did you say also the 45 now?
I don't remember. I'm just putting it out there because I don't know.
Okay. Okay. But if Ish wanted one of the guns, you would allow him to...
It only happened... Me lending the guns only happened twice.
Okay.
Tops. The car was all the time, but...
Pardon?
I lent the car out a lot, but the guns, only twice.
Okay. And Ish knew about the other guns in the house, right?
I don't know.
Okay. Well, do you remember talking to a grand jury in this case?
Yes.
And it was a place that was a courtroom sort of setting, right?
Yes.
And like you are here, you were on a witness stand and you were sworn in, right?
Yes.
And you swore to tell the grand jury the truth, right?
Correct.
And that was last year around March? That sound about right? About a year ago?
Yes.
Okay, March 21st, 2022, does that sound about right?
Yeah.
And when you were talking to the grand jury under oath, you were asked, and you said that you thought Ish would know where the guns were because he was a friend of yours, so you were sure it came up. Is that right?
If I said it, yep.
Sounds right to you?
Yep.
So Ish did know where the guns were. I mean, that you had the guns, right?
I guess.
Okay. I don't want to put any words in your mouth, so would it help you to look at your grand jury testimony?
No, we were all friends, so what they saw in my house, I don't know. I'm just assuming they knew they were there, but I don't know.
So you were asked, do you recall, that did Ish know where the other guns were? And you said, I think he did know. Does that sound right?
Yeah.
And you were asked, why do you say that? And you said, because he's a friend of mine, so I'm sure it came up, right?
Right. They were in my house. Yeah.
And you had been sober for over a year before that grand jury testimony, right?
Yep.
And Ish didn't really come over when Chris was around, right?
He would.
Okay. Now, Chris was out of town from the end of September, September 29th he left, right?
I believe so.
And sometimes Chris was gone for weeks at a time, sometimes only a week, right?
Yep.
But it was usually for the full week, Monday through Friday.
It was all random times.
Okay. And on this time, he came back less than a week, right?
Yeah.
He came back on October 2nd.
Yes.
And while he had been gone, you had been using crack for days on end.
Yep.
And you were able to... Well, it caused you to stay up for days on end, right?
Yep.
And when you wanted more, you would reach out for more, right?
Correct.
And Ish was one of the places that you reached out to more for.
Correct.
And when you said that Chris came home and he discovered his guns missing, you had a big fight. Or you had a fight.
He had a fight with himself.
Okay. So you weren't concerned?
Well, I was concerned, but we weren't fighting with each other. He was just mad at the world.
Okay.
Well, throwing Chris, things.
Chris was actually confronting you to try and find out what happened, right?
No.
Okay. And Chris discovered other items more than the guns were missing, right?
I don't know.
Okay. Well, he confronted you with the other items missing, like the wedding ring, the speakers, the watch.
No, I don't remember that.
And
I just remember looking for the guns and the whole house.
Okay. Well, you told Chris that the guns and the other items must have been stolen, right?
I don't know about that.
Okay. Well, let's talk about when the officer came. When the officer came, he also confronted you with the missing guns, right?
Yeah.
And he confronted you with the missing guns and the other items that Chris had listed, and you said they must have been stolen.
He didn't give me a list. We were talking about the guns. I didn't know Chris said anything about rings and watches, and I just thought he told it was just the guns to the police.
So you're saying the officer did not confront you about the other items missing?
Okay. Not that I remember or thought.
Okay. So are you saying that he could have, but you don't remember?
I guess.
Okay. All right. And
Chris said he was calling the cops to report the guns stolen. I said, yeah, we should do that. He did it, called me over. I said, yeah, they're gone.
Okay. So that night, you told the police that, not that night, I'm sorry, when the officer showed up, you told him that you and your daughter had gone to sleep around 10 o'clock that night, right?
Which night is this?
The night before Chris came home.
Okay.
Do you recall that?
It's 4 years ago. I'm trying to remember.
Okay. I actually have to ask you, and perhaps we can ask the officer as well later, but you told the officer that the night before Chris came home, you fell asleep at 10, right?
Okay.
Does that sound right?
Sure.
And that you woke up around 11 o'clock to let the dog out.
Okay.
Do you recall that?
No.
Do you think if I show you the officer's report, it'll refresh your recollection?
Maybe.
See if it refreshes your recollection, I'm going to ask you a couple of more things about what you told the officer that night. You told him that You got up at around 11 to let the dog out, and you must have left the door unlocked. Does that sound right?
Possible.
Okay, and that the next morning the door was wide open. Is that right?
The back door was open.
Okay. Yeah. So when you're saying that you didn't really know if things were stolen or not, that was sort of when Chris is talking about missing items and you're saying your door is wide open the night before.
We did a lot of drugs. The door would be open here and there, unlocked, so it didn't surprise me.
Okay. So now I'm going to show you a copy of the police report from October 3rd, 2019. It's a three-page document, but I'm going to point your attention to a couple of paragraphs on the last page, those three. But okay. I want you to feel free to look at any part of that. And then I'm going to ask you some questions. Okay.
Yeah.
So, reviewing that, does that refresh your recollection about whether the officer confronted you about the items and you said you thought they were stolen?
Not really.
Okay. Does that refresh your recollection about whether you told the officer that you went to bed on the couch with your daughter? 22, I think, is 10 p.m., right? Around 10, and then got up.
It says it, I just don't remember it. I'm just being honest, though.
So it doesn't refresh your recollection about whether you told the officer that?
No.
And does it refresh your recollection about when you say that you woke up around in the morning and the rear door was open?
That was the morning. That was a different morning.
Okay.
I'm so confused.
Okay. Did you tell the officer the truth when he responded on 10/3/19?
Yes.
Okay. You did not tell the officer that Adam was over. When you talked to him on 10/3/19, right?
Correct.
You did tell the officer that you had been home all of the time that Chris was gone, right?
Yep.
And you told him that you would, you didn't have anyone over that whole time, right?
Right.
So you didn't tell him the truth?
I told him the truth. I've always told the truth.
Okay.
My thing is, I never even thought Adam would do that. So when people ask me, I didn't think it was necessary to say if I had a friend over or not.
Okay.
Who cares?
And you didn't tell the officer that you had Ish over, right?
I don't know about that.
Okay. So one of the things that you talked about on direct was that whoever stole the guns didn't take the .45 because it was in your car, right?
Right.
And sort of you're assuming that if your .45 had been in the drawer when the guns were taken, the 45 would be gone today.
That's what I'm assuming, yep.
But because it was in the car, it was not among the missing guns, right?
Correct.
And yet the 45 was in the drawer when Chris came home, right?
I don't remember that.
Okay. Well, if Chris remembers that, Chris, you don't recall that the 45 was there when Chris came home and he confronted you about it?
No.
And you don't recall that the officer asked about the 45 and why it was still there while the others were gone?
No.
And you do recall that the guns that were reported missing was the 380 pistol from the drawer and the two guns under the bed, right?
Yes.
So somehow or other, that 45 got into the drawer after those three guns are taken, right?
Sure.
And if they were in the drawer before Chris got home, then it was probably you that put that gun in the drawer, right?
I guess so.
And if it was after the guns were taken, then you would have seen that the guns were missing.
No.
Okay.
His drawer is like this full of all his boxers and socks and what else in there.
Okay,
so it's not necessary. Okay. I would have seen it in there.
Okay.
So you would bury them in the back.
All right. So I'm going to talk about you said, I believe on direct, that you never touched the big guns.
Correct.
You didn't like them, and I think you kind of went like that when you said it, shaking your hands. Gives you the willies a bit, huh?
I like the guns, I just don't know how to use them, so I wouldn't touch them.
Okay. And the guns are kind of heavy, right? I mean, it's got some heft to it. And I think Chris said, does it sound right that the shotgun's even bigger than this rifle here?
Sure.
A bit heavier?
Sure.
And you told the police that you moved the guns behind the couch while Chris was gone.
I remember saying that, yeah.
Okay. So you told the police on 9...
I told them, I believe, it. They were either under the bed or behind the couch.
Okay.
One or the other.
So when the first officer arrived, you told him that you knew that the guns were present under the bed on September 30th because you stubbed your toe while you were making the bed, right?
Sure.
Do you recall that?
Yes.
Okay. And then when you talked to the grand jury, you told them that you had moved the guns behind the couch.
Yep.
And you had taken them from the bed to behind the couch.
I remember doing that at some point. I just don't remember when it was. So that timing, there was no time. So.
Okay. And you told the grand jury that you did that because bad things happened in the area, and you wanted the guns somewhere where you could grab them.
Sure.
You want to see your grand jury testimony?
Nope.
So do you know that that is what you told the grand jury back in March 21, 2022?
Makes sense, as I remember moving them.
And earlier on direct here in front of the jury, you said you never touched the big guns.
Well... Okay, yep.
And you told me one of the reasons you didn't touch them is they kind of gave you the willies, right?
Sure.
And that they were too big for you to use, right?
Sure. By myself, but yeah.
Okay. But you told the grand jury that you put them behind the couch where you could grab them.
Well, anyone can just move them. I'm not picking them up to shoot them.
Okay. One of the other things that you talked to the grand jury about was where you slept. You slept on the couch while Chris was gone?
Yes.
With your daughter?
Yes.
Why?
Why not? It's my house. It's my couch.
Okay. So you have a bed in your room that you share with Chris.
We don't like each other, me and my ex.
So are you saying that even when Chris was there, you slept on the couch?
Yes.
Okay. So one of the reasons that you might be sleeping on the couch while Chris was away is that was where you normally slept.
Right.
Okay. And then your daughter normally slept in her room?
Yeah.
And she was 2 at the time?
Yes.
And you had her sleeping on the couch with you while Chris was gone?
Yes.
Just, you wanted to make sure she was safe?
Yes.
And being in the house without Chris there, you wanted her close to you so that she would be safe?
Correct.
Okay. And one of the reasons that you said that you brought the guns to behind the couch was because your child was there and you put them behind the couch where you slept so you could hear. Is that right?
Correct.
Hear if somebody came in and they would be close by to be able to use?
No, so they wouldn't get stolen.
Concern of yours that somebody might be interested in the guns, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and is your friend knew where they were, right?
I guess so, yeah.
Okay, because you had let him at least told him before, right?
I don't remember that, but sure.
Did you?
I don't know. I could have. I could have.
Okay. And I think on direct you said that you thought Adam was there a day or two before Chris got home.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But you know that the guns were under the bed on September 30th, because that's where you stubbed your toe while making your bed.
Yes.
Okay. And he came back the night of October 2nd.
Yes.
Okay. The wedding ring that you pawned in
yes.
August, that was worth about $1,000?
Don't know, but maybe about okay. that.
You pawned it for 50?
Yeah, I tried to get it back 6 days later, but it was a day too late, so he wouldn't give it back to me.
Okay. And it's one of the reasons that you pawn things is that you get less money for it for the option that they hold on to, for the option that the pawn shop holds on to an item so that you could get it back.
Correct.
And you had only gotten $50 for that ring when you pawned it, right?
Yeah, I don't remember how much, but.
I'm showing you exhibit 7A through 17 or 7? 7A
through E.
Does that, you identify that as the information about your pawning the ring, right?
Yes.
That showed that you pawned it for $50?
Yes.
And so you essentially, if that ring was worth $1,000, kind of threw away $950 by being a day late with the $50, right?
Yes.
So you mentioned also on direct Mike Sullivan, right?
Yes.
And he was somebody that you also did drugs with?
Yes.
You'd hang out at his house to do drugs?
Both. Okay. Houses.
Both?
Yeah. Mostly his house, but he would come to mine too.
Okay. And Mike was a friend of Ishmael Garcia's, right?
We were all friends, yeah.
Okay. And when Chris returned and was really mad, throwing things on October 2nd, called the police on October 3rd, and you're not sure, but you may have been at Mike Sullivan's.
Correct.
Because you wanted to get away from Chris.
Probably.
And Chris was there to watch your daughter, so you could.
Probably.
And so you went to Mike's, probably to do some more drugs?
Maybe.
Maybe. And you talked about the missing guns with the people there, right?
Probably, yeah.
And you told them that Ish and Manny took the guns?
I could have, yeah.
Okay. And Mike actually talked to Ish and Manny and came back to you about what he said. I'm not sure.
The objection is sustained. You can rephrase the question.
A little after she was accusing, you may have been accusing Ish and Manny, Mike had a conversation with you, right?
Yes.
And after that, you started accusing a whole bunch of people there, right?
I don't remember that.
You sort of accused everybody there, right?
No.
Okay. And you continued going to Mike's after that, right?
Yes.
And you would accuse different people while you were at Mike's?
No.
Okay.
That's crazy.
And while at Mike's, you talked about a video that you claimed to have. Right?
No.
And you said that with the video, it showed who took the gun, right?
No.
And nobody had been arrested for the gun, right?
No.
And it's pretty clear that if you had a video of somebody with the gun, somebody would have been arrested, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So your conversation about videos, wherever you had it, was just kind of made up, right?
I don't even know what you're talking about, but okay.
Okay. Well, you did talk about having a conversation about a video, right?
And I said that the cops were going to the houses around me looking at four video cameras.
Okay.
If they had them, to see who came in and out of the house.
Okay.
And that's when I said that to Kayla, and Kayla's answer was, which way do they point?
Okay. So I just need to make sure that you are saying you...
I had never had a video.
That you did not, while at Mike Sullivan's place, talk about a video.
I don't think so.
Okay. May have, you're not sure.
I don't remember.
Okay. Now, on December 19 is when you were arrested, 2019. Sound right?
Yes.
And I think you described napping at the gas station with drugs on your lap.
Yes.
And police came up and you got arrested.
Correct.
Very early morning hours, right?
Correct.
And they talked to you about the prior report of Chris about the missing guns, right?
Maybe.
Hmm?
Maybe.
Okay. And you told them that you had moved the guns into the bedroom, right?
I don't understand the question.
We'll move on. That. So you told them at that time that Mr. Montgomery was over, right?
No.
Okay. You told them that you went to work the next morning and told Mr. Montgomery to lock the door behind on his way out, right?
I don't remember all that.
Okay. And you don't remember, will reading the report refresh your recollection?
No, because the last one really didn't, so.
Okay. And when you went to the grand jury, you were asked about that report to the police officers, right?
Yes.
So at the grand jury, you were asked about the part of the report where it says Frayne, I think they're Kimberly Frayne, said it made sense since Montgomery was there the night the guns were taken, that you were called that night and said that you had just moved the guns into your bedroom to be near your daughter when Montgomery was over, that you explained when you went to work in the morning, you told Montgomery to lock the door behind you on him on the way out, and that Montgomery was the only one home. And you were asked about that, and you said, well, that's not true.
Yeah, I don't remember that.
And at the grand jury, you were asked if you remembered saying that, and you said, maybe, sort of.
Sounds right.
Okay.
Maybe sort of.
That maybe you remembered some of it, sort of, but it wasn't true, right?
I don't remember that at all.
Okay. But you agree that you said it, just that it wasn't true.
I'm confused.
We'll move on.
Okay.
By the way, you never mentioned Ish to the police in December of 2019, right?
I don't know why I would have.
And you didn't mention Ish in October of 2019, right?
I don't know why I would have.
Okay. Now, when Adam stopped by that night, I think that you testified on direct that he was there and the two of you were trying to find drugs.
Correct.
So he didn't have drugs and you didn't have drugs.
Correct.
And you were going to contact people to try and get drugs.
Correct.
And that maybe Adam would drive if that worked out.
Sure.
Which is why Adam is there with you, because otherwise you can both make phone calls, right?
Yeah, what?
Okay, so you called
Adam. He came over and we hung out. That's about that.
I think you said on direct you called Adam over because you wanted drugs, right?
Probably.
And so you called Adam over because you didn't want to leave your daughter? To get drugs?
Probably.
And you called Adam over probably because your car wasn't there to take your daughter with you to get drugs, right?
I don't know about that.
Why?
I don't remember.
Okay. But that might be a reason to call somebody over if you can't go and drive the drugs for the drugs when you find them, right?
They usually get brought to me.
As a matter of fact, Ish would bring them to you when you called, right?
Ish would, yeah.
And if he had your car, he would bring your car, return it when you called for drugs, right?
Correct.
And you talked about drugs being in the house in the morning, right?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry, Your Honor, I got ahead of myself. Before the grand jury, on February 12th of 2022, the police came to you to speak to you about Adam Montgomery, right?
Sure.
Do you recall that you spoke to the police the same year as you went to the grand jury, but before?
No.
You don't?
No.
You recall speaking to a Detective Rahill?
I remember the name, yes.
And February 13, 2022 is a little over a month before March 21, 2022, right?
Yes.
And you sitting here today, I think you said that your memory problems are so much better because you're not doing drugs anymore, right?
Well, they're clear now, but you're asking me to remember things from 4 years ago when I was in a not a great spot, so I'm trying my best.
Okay. I'm actually asking about a year ago when you were saying that you were in a good spot.
Okay.
Do you remember talking to the police for a fair amount of time, about a month or so before the grand jury?
Probably.
But you have no recollection of that.
I remember talking to them.
Okay. When I just, may we approach?
Yes.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's almost 12:30, so I think this is a good time for you to take a lunch break. So I'm going to have you come back at 1:25. We'll start again at 1:30. I'm going to ask the witness to please remain on the witness stand for now. Then we'll release you, and you'll come back to complete the examination.
To go to work.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please remain, and ladies and gentlemen, you can go ahead and take a break. All rise for the jurors, please. We'll see you back please come back at 1:25.
No, I'm leaving. I have to go.
Why doesn't everybody else come back at 20 after, okay? And we'll have so that they can tell you what will happen if you are not back on this stand at 1:25. Okay.